Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Salam mubarak, salam mahabbah pada semua yang telah menyaksikan siaran bicara Medan Muzakarah Ehwal Semasa di TV Al-Hijrah. Kami membawa kepada anda satu topik yang sangat menarik, sangat penting kerana ia menyebabkan masyarakat seluruh dunia agak merisaukan tentang apa yang dikatakan Islam itu sendiri dan Muslim. Jadi kita nak memberikan gambaran bahawa apakah sebenarnya diistilahkan sebagai Islamofobia itu, fobia terhadap Islam, dan bagaimanakah harusnya kita berharapan dengan suasana. Dan untuk itu kita ada tiga tetamu kita, ialah tetamu-tetamu dari luar negara sebenarnya. Boleh saya izinkan saya untuk memperkenalkan mereka, dan kalau boleh saya perkenalkan yang di sebelah saya ini, sebelah kanan adalah Sheikh Imam Dr. Suhaib Webb. Ya, seorang dikatakan sebagai aktivis Islam Amerika. Ya, beliau merupakan seorang yang telah pun mendapat pendidikan di Universiti Al Azhar, dan beliau merupakan seorang yang juga sebahagiannya seorang Malaysia kerana isterinya seorang Melayu Malaysia. Ya, you can understand me. Welcome, Imam. Di sebelah saya ini adalah kita telah jumpa beliau ketika kita membicarakan soal saudara baru, cabaran saudara baru, iaitu saudara Abdul Qadir ataupun dulunya dikenal sebagai Benjamin Davis. Once upon a time, ya. Yeah. And welcome again, brother. Right. Beliau merupakan seorang volunteer ataupun sukarelawan di Perkim, Pertubuhan Kebajikan Islam Malaysia. Dan di ujung sekali, kalau anda dapat lihat siaran TV Al-Hijrah, kita ada tazkirah, beliau terlibat dengan program tazkirah. Beliau adalah Munir A. Rashid, iaitu seorang konsultan Persatuan Pengguna Islam Malaysia ataupun consultant for the Islamic Consumer Association of Malaysia, PPIM. Welcome everybody. Dan izinkan saya sebenarnya membicarakan dengan ketiga-tiga mereka dalam bahasa Inggeris, kerana itu yang bahasa yang mungkin senang fahami. Jadi again, welcome the three of you for coming over to talk about Islamophobia. And I'm sure many of us would want to know many things about the perceptions of the community that you were in. Right, I got to know that, brother, when 9/11 took place, you were in Taiwan, you were in UK, and you were in, of course, America. And when it happened, all of you were already Muslims.
Yes.
Right? Now the question that I need to find out from all of you is that before we go on into your experience, probably what do you feel, how do you feel about this phenomena or the stigma called Islamophobia? I think, well, the Imam is here, let's listen to the Imam first. Right, Imam, what do you think about this Islamophobia?
Well, I lived in Egypt for 7 years, so I came back to America last summer at the height of the New York mosque crisis. And I think maybe my words would surprise you. I think some of it is warranted in the fact that Muslims in America have not perhaps done as good a job as they could have done in relating what Islam is to their fellow citizens. So the Arabs say, "Adamu ma'rifa yufiru shidda," that not knowing something makes it difficult. So actually there's empirical studies that show that those people who were Islamophobes, around 85% of them who got to know Muslims completely changed their philosophy and became open-minded. Mm-hmm. So those kind of empirical studies would show that a lot of it rests with us as a community to reach out and educate people about Islam. Mm-hmm. And we do have a large immigrant community in America who doesn't really understand the cultural fabric of America. So that kind of undermines their ability to speak the language of the hood, as we say, speak the language of the taman, mm-hmm. of the neighborhood that mm-hmm. they live in. Mm-hmm. So I think that it's unjust. I think it's definitely something we should be concerned about. But again, I think as a community, we have a responsibility to educate people about what Islam is.
All right. Brother Abdul Qadir, you were in UK, your home ground. So how was it then?
Personally, I blended quite nicely. I didn't have any direct problems. But of course, my wife is a hijabi, and even my daughters, and they were feeling the stress a lot. Just the added sense of pressure from the society, from the community at large, and there were unfortunate incidences against, you know, the overt sign of Islam is the hijab, mm-hmm. and so unfortunately sisters in UK have ever since really, to higher or to larger or lesser extent, been receiving difficulties, and I think throughout Europe in fact.
What's your take on this stigma of Islamophobia?
Well, first of all, I want to say about, let's understand the word. Phobia means a fear which is irrational or irrationally expanded beyond what it should be. So people might be phobic of heights. That means they step close to the edge of even a step, they get palpitations. It's irrational.
Mm-hmm.
I think this way, actually, what is Islamophobia is badly named, and it's for a purpose of creating that same fear in the Muslims,
mm-hmm.
because there are people who are ignorant of Islam, and but there's also really a hatred of Islam. It is not a phobia. There is a genuine hatred.
There is hatred,
and there is an ignorant hatred, which is fostered. But I don't think that the people are scared of Islam so to that extent. I think, mm-hmm. You know, we shouldn't feel emotionalized about it.
Mm-hmm.
This is my take on it.
Right. Maybe we can also see, while we're discussing, probably see some of the pictures that we have here that can give us an idea of what had happened before. And probably there still is such feeling around. Maybe we can look at the pictures. Well, we listen to Brother Munir, probably could also, maybe you can comment on those pictures of your experience. You were in Taiwan, but when you came back to America, what was the impression? All right, probably this as you can see, the some of the pictures, of course, the Twin Tower World Center. And these are the pictures that you find in the web. You can see this kind of things happening in the Western world, how people react to Islam and putting labels on us.
Mm-hmm.
Okay,
brother, right, brother. Comment now.
Yeah.
As you mentioned, I was in Taiwan during the time, and as we talked about earlier, we do have a community of Muslims there. But they said that the media came to look at us during our Friday prayers to see what would be said, what would be our reaction, would there be anything incendiary projected from us from the pulpit, let's say, during the Friday prayer. Fortunately, nothing like that happened. And after a few weeks, the media stopped coming because there was another event that had taken place in Taiwan. But getting back to Islamophobia, we have to realize that there are different types of it. You have governmental Islamophobia, and you have societal Islamophobia. The governments have their own purpose for not wanting Islam to spread, because Islam, as we were taught by the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, the Nation of Islam, that Islam will free a person from the enslavement that maybe some governments would have them in. So the purpose of some of these governments is to keep people subjected to the rule to not think and to not bring about change. Another thing that happened in our sojourn in the United States over the 80 years since the beginning of the Nation of Islam is that we as a people, I'm talking about the black man and woman in the United States, were being cleaned up from drugs, from alcohol, from all the social vices that were being put on us by those who formerly owned us. And when people lose revenue because we are no longer gamblers, we're no longer drunkards, we're no longer smoking reefers and doing all those things, there's a fear there. We have to keep them into that state so we can control them, mm-hmm. and economically we have a power over them as well. Getting back to Islamophobia, we have to also look at pre-9/11, pre-September 11th, I should say, that even one of the lawmakers in the United States of America said after the end of communism that our next enemy to our way of life is Islam. So the seeds had already been planted pre-9/11 for this fear, for this disdain for Islam to take place. Mm-hmm. So that was taking place in the United States. As we were just watching the monitor, mm-hmm. a little while ago, we saw the images they've been portraying around the world.
Mm-hmm.
Those of Osama bin Laden supposedly holding a gun. And they even had one they called a silver bullet, that him purportedly bragging about his being behind 9/11. And it turned out they just had somebody else, an actor, so to speak, a chubby sort of fella who looked nothing like bin Laden, but because people thought that this was bin Laden,
mm-hmm.
they believed that he was behind it.
All right, we have now heard the expression and the impression about Islamophobia by three of our speakers here. Jadi sudah kita dengarkan pandangan-pandangan mereka. Sudah tentu kita nak tahu lagi lebih lanjut bagaimana pengalaman ketika itu dan pengalaman berhadapan dengan Islamophobia di tempat masing-masing. Jadi saudara, apa kata kita dalam bicara istirahat seketika dan kembali sejurus lepas ini untuk membincangkan lagi tentang Islamophobia. Jangan ke mana-mana. Bicara ingin bicarakan tentang satu topik sangat penting, sangat menarik, dinamakan Islamophobia. Menarik kerana kita ingin menarik perhatian anda bagi kita mengetahui bagaimanakah keadaannya dan bagaimana berharapannya. Untuk perbincangan dalam pusingan kedua ini, kita akan sebab-sebab mengenai bagaimana berhadapan, bagaimana masyarakat Islam dan teman-teman kita ini berhadapan dengan suasana itu ketika berhadapan dengan keadaan yang sangat kritikal pada waktu 9/11 dan sebagainya. Maybe the Imam could you share with us, Imam Shaikh, how did you all, or rather and the Muslims in the vicinity that you're in, face with this Islamophobia phenomenon?
Well, I think what we did is really try to exemplify what the Prophet Muhammad, the final prophet sent to humanity, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, taught us, and there was no prophet after him ever, and that is, or messenger, and that is that we try to turn it into a positive. I mean, the Prophet said that if you have a seed in your hand and it's the last moment of your life, right, day of judgment, plant the seed. Always turn something into a positive. He said, "Ajab al-amr mu'min." I'm amazed by the affair of the believer. It's always good for them. So what happened was is that a number of people actually came to our mosques to see. I think, as Brother Munir mentioned, what happened in Taiwan, people actually came to the mosque expecting to hear, you know, what they saw on TV, similar to the images that you showed. Mm-hmm. And Allah says in the Quran, لِتَعَرَفُ. He created us to know one another. And because of that, a large influx of especially Latino people have become Muslim. Mm-hmm. I'd say almost every week in the mosque that I'm at in America, at least one or two people, we've had an entire family become Muslim. We've had a woman who was in her 60s and her daughter that was in her 20s. Or the vast majority of people just leave becoming allies of the community, which is very crucial for us. So our experience, although there was some negative, definitely phone calls, women with hijab being the object of threats, but in comparison to what, for example, Muslims are going through in Gaza, or Muslims are going through in Kashmir and other places, it's nothing. Mm-hmm. And really, I think we have to really strike a difference between European Islam and American Islam. Mm-hmm. The cultures are extremely different. Mm-hmm. American people don't tend to have some of the historical roots maybe that exist in Europe as far as Islam and the Crusades and the church. So the American people kind of came with just kind of curiosity. Mm-hmm. Even there was a guy who came to the mosque who was really anti-Muslim. Mm-hmm. And we had a brother that gave a very, very profound speech about what Islam was. And the guy told me, this American man, he said, you know, this is a good message. Mm-hmm. This is a message I can understand. Mm-hmm. So we tried to turn it into more of an educational effort and take, instead of pointing the finger at other people, taking responsibility for ourselves, educating the people, getting out involved in other organizations, non-Muslim organizations, other faith groups, the Jews, the Christians, the Buddhists, were extremely helpful. Many of them got us in contact with people that would facilitate even media opportunities for us. So from that perspective, we were able to turn it into a positive. Secondly, Muslims in America realize the importance of human rights organizations as well as civil rights organizations. Mm. So a large number of young Muslims actually went into the law fields now, coming out as lawyers, starting NGOs, which basically are designed to defend the rights of Muslims in America.
There is a civil lining. Yeah.
I mean, President Obama actually appointed Hafiz al-Quran as his representative of Islam to the OIC. I know that brother's name is Rashid Khalil. Uh-huh. And he actually is a lawyer. I mean, if he had not gone to Yale Law School, he would have never been in a position to be appointed as the representative for the Muslim community in America.
You were saying about the difference between Islam, the reactions of those in America as opposed to what's happening in Europe. Maybe Brother Abdul Qadir can share with us the reaction in UK.
There's extremes.
How do you keep it?
There was extremes, actually. The response in UK was there was maybe the older generation were very apologetic and very kind of, you know, just, well, you know, Islam is peace and these people are evil, they're not proper Muslims. Mm-hmm. who are doing this, and we denounce them, and they are outside Islam, and there was this reaction. And then the other extreme reaction was the younger generation who are saying, how can you throw these allegations at us? You are invading countries, you are killing people all the time, why is this not considered terrorism? Mm-hmm. And then and beyond that also, they would say anything inflammatory, and they considered some of the personalities in the UK who have now been expelled considered actually that any kind of media exposure is good. Whether it is negative or positive, it will be positive because Allah will make it positive due to, you know, that they plan, you plan and they plan, but Allah is the best of planners. Mm. From this saying, they decided that. And they would say the most outrageous things, mm-hmm. actually, mm. and caused the apologetic Muslims to become even more apologetic. Mm-hmm. And so this is the problem. It was a polarization, mm-hmm. in Europe. There's a very big polarization. The more gentle and soft Muslims are melting into the society, mm-hmm. and the radicals, the ones who actually have some fire in their belly, are being alienated and pushed to the sides and are sticking out. Mm. Like tall grass.
Yes.
Whether you're going to,
yeah, well, to that? Add something to that. When he mentioned about Muslims becoming very apologetic, that phenomenon has taken place in America as well. Not amongst Americans or those born in America who become Muslims, but those who are green card holders, they almost feel fearful of expressing their belief, only because they fear that possibly if they show their Islamic fervor or love for Islam too much, maybe they will lose their status and be sent back home. So you have families who may encourage their daughters, I'm talking about those who immigrated to America, not to wear the hijab, and they want to melt into society so they can blend in. Mm-hmm. The problem with a lot of that was that right after 9/11, those who thought they could blend in physically, people still recognized them to be from other places, and there was a backlash towards them. Okay. Going back over to Europe just for a quick second, you have racism being mass from xenophobia, or I would say Islamophobia, because you have a large influx of people from, let's say, the Middle East. Or Pakistan, Afghanistan, Africa, etc., who are of the Islamic faith, who have gone to Europe. And so this is causing a problem because you have the older generation in Europe who's no longer going to the churches, but mosques are being built here and there. And they're more expressive of their Islamic faith. So there's a fear there as well. So you have an organization that sprung up, and I think our brother here knows about it. It's called Stop the Islamization of Europe. So you have that there. They have the counterpart in the United States. And you have people like this lady Giller, who's also saying we should destroy the Dome of the Rock. Mm-hmm. So we have this kind of rhetoric and of people who are fearful of their status. What we call the status quo of their colonial past, then they don't want to see that change.
Yeah. I think something else is important.
Is that people like Gellner, actually, when we actually, as I mentioned, one of the fruits of the whole process is we did realize, and I think also Brother Munir mentioned it earlier, that we divided the Islamophobes into like two or three camps. Mm-hmm. One of them are those who actually hate Islam. I mean, they do not like Islam, they hate Muslims, yeah. They're bigots, they don't like blacks, they don't like Jews, they don't like anyone. And these people are a minority, but they have a lot of money and they do have support. And the reason that they have support is in many ways they were used to win elections, to create a fear in the heart of the electorate, which caused them to come and vote. So, for example, Gellner now is completely quiet. Before November, the congressional elections which happened, which were crucial in America, mm-hmm. for the Republicans to take the House, there's no way they're going to take the Senate. So Islam was made a huge discussion, right. Yes. Where it has no relevance to American society. So, for example, where I'm from, Oklahoma, they actually passed a bill called, you know, Save Our State, which meant that Sharia law can never be applied in Oklahoma. Well, Sharia law has never been applied in Oklahoma. John Stewart, very famous political commentator, said, well, that's like passing a bill that says it's illegal to kidnap rabbits. I mean, who kidnaps rabbits? Nobody. Yes. So we had this initial group, and how we dealt with them was with lawyers, with skilled human rights activists and scholars. I mean, we had debates with these people, and people realized they didn't know anything. They don't know anything. They know very little about Islam, and they were exposed, and they were charging like $75,000 speaker fees. I mean, they milked even the right financially, but they did galvanize a electorate that went and voted for them. And the fear is that in 2012, because of the importance of the election coming up and the willingness of the Republicans to be politically irresponsible in order to win an election, that they are going to try to put that bill on every ballot in every state on 2012 to galvanize the hillbillies and the rednecks and the radicals to come out and vote. I mean, the liberals and the right-minded people in America never lose an election by voting. They lose it by not voting, right? So their theory is that if we can galvanize our supporters. The second group are those who are Islamophobes, either due to false information or just simply because they've been exposed to wrong things. And the third are just the ignorant people. So for the second and third tier, we basically engage in education campaigns to try to deal with them. But it is definitely been used more so for political fodder than anything else. You don't hear about the New York mosque controversy in America anymore. Up until the day of the election, there was at least, if you Googled it, at least 30 to 40 news media pieces.
Massive.
Yeah, exactly, because they wanted to Islamicize the election. And then the theory that Barack Obama himself is a closet Muslim. Although he didn't fast in the month of Ramadan, he doesn't pray five times a day, and he's been seen drinking wine. So I don't know what type of Muslim he is, right?
He is. Right. Now, the next discussion probably will see how should we cope with this, the Muslims all over, should we cope with all this kind of, you know, stress that we might say that they are facing at this point in time. Jadi saudara, selepas itu kita akan sembang-sembangkan pula mengenai bagaimanakah masyarakat Islam di tempat masing-masing di seluruh dunia ini harus berhadapan dengan apa yang disilakan sebagai Islamofobia ini, yaitu kebencian terhadap Islam dan masyarakat Islam itu seluruhnya. Jadi saudara, kita kembali untuk bincangkan lagi tentang Islamofobia dalam bicara. Bersama dengan bicara, kita bincang-bincangkan mengenai Islamofobia. Baik, kita sudah mengatakan bahawa kita ingin bicarakan bagaimana harus kita berhadapan, umat Islam khususnya di seluruh dunia berhadapan dengan Islamofobia ini. So, we open to the floor. What do you think should we do now as Muslim after 10 years of the worst experience that we had from 9/11? Probably whether we want to share.
I think the easiest thing to say is Segalanya bermula di sini. Our tagline. The reason why I say it starts here. It starts with each one of us. I'm always surprised when someone comes up to me and they ask, is Michael Jackson or was Michael Jackson a Muslim, or could you hear the azan in space? And I say, well, what does it matter? What's the importance of Michael Jackson as compared to another fellow who never known about Islam and he comes into the deen? So I say we have to have confidence in our own belief structure regardless of whichever celebrity of the day accepts or does not accept Islam. And that's what people were asking about the election our brother was just mentioning, Sheikh was just mentioning about Obama. People are still wondering, is he really a Muslim? Do we have a champion in the White House? It doesn't make a difference. Right. The champion is the person you look at every day who has that faith, and those who have yet to come into the understanding of Islam. Now we're talking about them accepting, but we have to give them a clear understanding, and it starts with us, as this TV station's tagline.
Yes. What about you, brother?
Okay, a beautiful first statement, mashallah. What I would also add is, this is not a new problem. This is the bottom line, it's not a new problem. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he had enemies. They tried to extinguish Islam with their mouths. Even before that, the Yahud, they killed their prophets. This is something that has gone on from the beginning of time. Since there were prophets, there have been enemies. There have been those who have been testing the prophets, testing the true believers. And so this is what we must remember. Actually, we are not... Islamophobia is a new name, old problem, very old problem. So this is, I think, the next thing that needs to be said after the first excellent comment. And we shouldn't be in apoplexy about it. Mm. It is the burden of the believers. Mm. We have to face this. This is something that should be a part of our life. And although it may cause us stress sometimes, you know, personal stress, cost to our lives or our family relationships, mm-hmm. this is the cost of right. being close to Allah.
But probably the biggest problem is that we are facing with this world media picturing us as what they feel that we are. We are British or not. Now, Imam, you have been all over the world probably. You have been in Egypt, you have been doing things in America. Now, how do we cope with that? I mean, with this media bashing against the Muslims and giving all sorts of untrue picture of what we are. So how do we cope with that?
Well, I think first of all, we have to be fair in our assessment of the media. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, the first thing he did when he went to Medina was not build a mosque. People always think that. But the first thing actually he did was order for a census to be taken of the citizens of Medina so he could have a clear understanding of who lived there and what was going on. Mm. I think a lot of times we tend to base emotions or facts on our emotions. So the entire media is against Islam and Muslims, or certain parts of the media are against Islam and Muslims. Last week CNN, actually in America, had an article that said, what if Jared, the guy who shot the congresswoman in Arizona, he said, what if he was a Muslim, then what would have happened? And basically saying it would not have been fair, we would have blamed the Muslim community. This is a non-Muslim who wrote this article. The Huffington Post has been very pro-Muslim, almost since day one, actually allowing even imams to post op-eds. The problem that we have in America in general is that we are not professional enough to engage media yet. And we do not have enough indigenous voices, people who have converted to Islam or born into America as Muslims, who can even effectively deal with media organizations. Mm-hmm. There are problems. Fox News, Sky News, okay. These are definitely very problematic figures. They're going to spew their hate. But as our brother said, they're not going to stop. Right? And the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Allah said, فَاسْتَقِمْ كَمَا أُمِرْتْ. Keep going, right? As you've been ordered to do. And I like what you said about Obama. I mean, Obama's a red herring for both sides of the table, right? The writer using Obama as a closet Muslim to scare the wits out of people. And Muslims are concerned, is he really Muslim or not? Is he praying tahajjud in the Oval Office? And it becomes all this rhetoric and platitudes with no real tangible organization. So what is happening, we have Muslim Media Watch now in America, are professionals, not imams. I'm not a media pro. I'm not a counselor. I'm not Dr. Phil. I'm not Oprah. I'm an imam. I can't do everything. And what has happened is effectively in communities which are larger, like in LA, San Francisco, New York City, Atlanta, Chicago, and other places, is to establish people in the right place and the right time to do the right job. Mm-hmm. So you have now media organizations actually being established in the Muslim community by people that have PhDs and masters in communications, mm-hmm. in media, and who understand how to connect with the media. Mm-hmm. And that's where really we got beat by the neocons. The neocons brought Islamophobes to America, like Ayana Hirsi Ali from Denmark and others, who had experience in dealing with the press and talking to the press myself. A lot of them say, we call Muslims and no one returns our phone call. We go to the mosque for interviews and everybody gets scared and doesn't want to speak to us. Mm-hmm. So yes. We have had to take the onus for ourselves and to create effective media organizations that can monitor the media to make sure that we're understanding data correctly. Secondly, offer information to the media and voices to the media that are consistent in a message and that also are professional in how they carry themselves.
I think the biggest problem about the Muslims is that they do not share this kind of information.
And you know, it's interesting, the Prophet also, in Mecca, where did he go to start his call? He went to the hill of Safa. Mm. Safa was the BBC of the Prophet's day. Mm. That was the best possible media outlet in Mecca. And he utilized it.
That means media played a very important role.
Exactly. Right. So the Muslim now should be looking for Safa, like TV Hijra, right? Wherever we are, there's a metaphoric Safa that we should be climbing and utilizing to reach the people.
So the role of the media plays a very important role. Now, how do we go about it? We don't have any, for example, an Islamic CNN, a Muslim CNN, or BBC for the Muslim. So how do we go about doing what our Imam has said?
One of the problems you'll face, and unfortunately is being faced, is advertising dollars. When you are subjecting yourself to advertisement, to make sure that you can stay on air, then you tend to kowtow, which means to bow down to those who own the purse strings to your bowl of rice, as we used to say in Taiwan. So if you are completely independent of that, you have a better chance of success, as our brothers were saying. You also need people who can articulate the message so the masses, not preaching to the choir, as we used to say back in my Christian days, because Muslims will always agree. But you want to get sympathizers among those who have yet to embrace Islam. One good thing I would say about those who are in Israel, their media people are very astute at delivering the message and doing in such a way, in such a manner, that people around the world find themselves agreeing with them. When we, a lot of times, get in front of the camera, especially those of our brothers in the Middle East, a lot of times we find it difficult to even listen. So after a few seconds, we want to turn to another station or completely turn it off. So as stated, we need a consistent message. We need a lobby like the IPEC in the United States, where we can have our voice, our concerns, and things that affect our community, but Islam is fair. Yeah. Because if you do right by the Muslim community, you do right by humanity, because Islam embraces humanity. So those who do not understand that message, if they were to be open to it, if the message got out to them, they would realize that Islam is fair to them. Closing point with that. We at Persatuan Pengguna Islam Malaysia, the Muslim Consumer Association, started off just dealing, working with the Muslim community. Today, we're looking at 2011. We've already expanded our efforts. We have Chinese coming to us. We have those of the Indian communities. And even we have people from overseas who are here in Malaysia coming to PPIM, asking us for assistance in areas that involves consumerism. Mm-hmm. Along with that, with people from the Middle East as well, and also from England, yeah, coming to us as well.
There's a point, you see, what we have done here, the positive things are not being shared totally by the Muslims as a whole. So we hear spots of things happening there, spots of things, but the majority of the Muslims are so ignorant of what's happening, right? So how do you go about? Probably we ask someone from UK to see things differently, probably.
Well, sharing, I mean, okay, the most obvious thing, internet. This, the bottom line is also, this is a way of reducing the cost burden of publication or of airing your views. It is virtually free.
I mean, the new media plays an important role. Uh-huh. Yeah?
So I think YouTube is a key factor for propagating your ideas, for sharing ideas, and right, pretty much everyone is, or anyone who has the inclination, is doing it anyway.
Okay. Now, we will continue to discuss. Now we will come to the conclusion block, as they say. Now, for that, we will be talking about where do we go. I mean, what's the future of Islam then and Muslims? Probably you can now think about the answers. Jadi sekarang kita akan bicarakan tentang kemana selepas ini. Apakah masa depan Islam di Eropa, di Amerika, maupun di dunia? Bagaimana harus kita berhadapan dan kita harus lakukan sesuatu mulai sekarang barangkali. Jadi apapun, kita akan kembali untuk membincangkan bagaimana kesudahannya perbincangan Islamofobia ini. Anda kembali bersama Bicara, ya, merupakan bedan muzakarah Ewas Masa di TV Al-Hijrah. Kita masih lagi bicara tentang Islamofobia dan kali ini kita nak merumuskan apakah sebenarnya masa depan Islam di Eropa, di Amerika, di mana-mana saja. Right, what will be the future now for Islam in Europe? I can see there seems to be a silver lining in this grey phenomena. So, probably Imam, could you give, you have got beautiful experiences in America that you have gone through. Can you share some of it?
Yeah, I don't know what the future holds, Allahu Alam, but this is the deen of Allah, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promises that He will protect His deen. Inna nahnu nazzalna dhikra wa inna lahu lahafidhun. We sent this deen and will protect this deen. And by default also he'll protect the people who hold on to this deen. So I think what's important in America is to maintain the course, to continue to practice Islam as Muslims, to inform people about Islam, and to also face the enemy, those people who are portraying Islam in the wrong way, those people who are defaming Islam and Muslims, as well as within the Muslim community, those who have hijacked our religion, have molested it. I think we need to speak to them from a position of power and not be fearful. And that's what goes back to leadership. Leaders have to take stands on both sides. Secondly, we need to really consider the younger generation of Muslims in America who are not really being spoken to. And what I mean by that is that for the convert community, what we've done for the most part over the last 20 years is go overseas and study, like I did, come back and then translate classical books and expect that to somehow galvanize a younger generation. Mm-hmm. Whereas most of these classical texts don't really speak, of course, to Facebook, to Twitter, to the realities of the streets, to drugs, to girls, to Beyonce, you name it. And there needs to be really a curriculum written for American Muslim youth that speaks to their life and empowers them to actually lead the community. Leadership should be a shared process. So that's really my focus now. And actually, we've established like focus groups with young people and asking them, what curriculum do you want? What would you like to hear Islam answer questions to? How would you like to interact with an imam? Why don't you feel comfortable with religious leadership? What could leadership do to empower you more? So that's really my focus, is more so on actually the Muslim community, the younger generations of Muslims actually being lost just because religion doesn't relate to them
exactly
in the society that they live in. The non-Muslims, I mean, for the most part, as I told you, I think at breakfast, they've been very supportive. I mean, there is a politicalized lot of loudmouth idiots who definitely have to be dealt with and spoken to. But even after 9/11, I mean, I told you I received phone calls from non-Muslims who told me, I'll send my son to your mosque with a gun to protect the community. I said, you know, we don't need any guns from the masjid. We have people calling us who are saying, you know, in the spirit of Harriet Tubman, if you need to like hide out in a house, if, you know, the rednecks, hillbillies come after you and try to kill you, you can stay in my home, we'll take care of you. So we were, you know, actually shown a lot of support and concern. But the Muslims now in America also have to stop playing the racial card and actually answer some of the serious questions that non-Muslims have about Islam. Mm-hmm. I'll give you a quick example. A friend of mine who's a Malaysian, you know him, who lives in California, his wife gave birth there to their baby daughter. Mm-hmm. She was in labor for 13 hours with a nurse and the brother. The nurse was a non-Muslim. After labor, the nurse came to me and said, I just want to ask you one question. I've had this question since I walked in and I saw your wife with this hijab on and everything, and you know, Malaysians, you're really nice people, but why do you want to kill us? Mm. So he said, what do you mean? She said, doesn't Islam teach you to kill us? Like, isn't that part of your belief?
Yeah, belief.
And he said, well, if I was ordered to kill you, I had amped opportunity to kill you a number of times where you've been over trying to help my wife. Here's a woman who is obviously just confused, right? True. So these are the people that really we have to speak to. But we can't speak to them if we're teaching people a curriculum that doesn't speak to their life.
True.
We cannot speak to American society with a medieval Islamic discourse.
Definitely. You got a good point there. Yes, Brother Qadir, that's the American saying. So how does the British say about this?
I would agree with that pretty much.
Okay.
I think just to expand that slightly, I'm sure that Imam is not talking about inventing a new Islam or recreating Islam, but you know, just using hikmah to express it in a way that resonates with the human, with a specific human, because it's for the whole of humanity, so it has to have many ways, as there are so many different human beings. And you know, with that, I mean, I think the bottom line is we can't, as Muslims, be scared of Islam, of showing Islam. And one of the problems of the apologetic stance is that they say Islam is terror, and you say Islam is peace. It doesn't actually mean anything. When you say Islam is peace, what does it mean? It sounds beautiful, it sounds gentle.
It's not a cliche.
But it's a cliche, it has no actual meaning. So you actually have to get into the nitty-gritty sometimes. Otherwise, that person who you say that to, they'll say,
it goes one year and it goes out.
They go out, they say exactly the same thing again. You've not changed their opinion.
Mm-hmm.
You know, how is Islam peace? You say, well, Islam has, you know, the Islamophobia is not just about terror, is it?
Yeah.
There's this whole stigma about Sharia. What is Sharia? Why do you people want Sharia? Well, we believe actually that stability and security in the society is more important than the individual's right to do whatever he wants. And this is why we are different from you, from the West, from the secular society. This doesn't mean one is right and one is wrong, but we believe we are right because we have taken the guidance from the Creator. You believe you're right because it's just what you're doing right now. Mm. You know, 50 years ago, or even now, in some places you believe prostitution is legal, with license or without license. You know, you have all of these different laws that you're practicing, and you're saying they're all equal, depending on the time and place. Mm-hmm. Except you're saying Islam is not equal. How can you say that? Mm. You know, we say we are correct because we have the guidance from Allah. So that actually, we have a solid foundation for saying we have a superior way of life. Mm-hmm. They do not have a basis for saying they are the superior way of life.
Right. Okay,
we can challenge them.
We can challenge them, yeah. In a good way. Yes.
In a good way, inshallah. You know, when I think of gold and you roll it out of the ground, it's sort of dirty. Sometimes it has to go through a refining process. I find that we as an ummah, we as Muslims, we as people, sometimes have to go through the heat. Maybe this is the heat, the refinement, that we as a Muslim community must go through so we can appreciate the gold which we are. And so I look at all this that the brother said earlier, that Allah is not unaware of this. I think sometimes we forget who's in control. We look at these superpowers, those who are making laws that are anti-Islam, thinking that they hold all the power in their hands, and we forget, if we truly believe in Allah, then we know He's not unaware. He is aware of all these things that are taking place. So what is our responsibility? To understand who we are, to be able to answer those questions when people ask, as he said, the nurse asked about his, do Muslims want to kill? If we don't understand ourselves what is Islam, there is no way we can talk to other people about it. And there are people in our societies who are curious about it. There are young people as well as our old people, those who are immigrants, let's say. We even have the phenomenon, let's say, in a society like Malaysia or Indonesia, where you may have adults who may not have practiced over the years and may not be as strong in understanding of Islam, to have programs where they won't feel ashamed. That's the problem with some of the older generation who are Muslims. They've been away so long, they feel embarrassed because they've forgotten how to pray. They forgot how to talk to their children about Islam. So we have to get to the grassroots level to so everyone is welcome to come in and talk and to discuss and to share all these things that they've learned in a safe, comforting, loving environment. Because unfortunately, we tend to have all the scholarly knowledge, but we forget, as others who want to convert us, they come with love, and that's how they get us.
Yes.
They talk to our hearts and not just our minds. We as Muslims have to learn how to love unconditionally and care for our neighbors, care for those who are downtrodden, not if they are Muslim, but even amongst the non-Muslim community.
Mm. All right, we got about a few minutes left. I'll give you all one, or rather half a second each, just to make a little conclusion. Probably.
I mean, there's not much else to be said. You know, خَيْرُ الْقَلَمْ قَلَّهُ أَهْدَهُ, the best speech is what's short and to the point. Just that we have to, I think, continue to benefit, as he mentioned. We're being casted, we're being molded through difficulties. The Prophet said that the Muslim يُجَرَّبُ بِالْبَلَى, that the Muslim is always molded and cast with hardships and difficulties. Right. So we have to take this as an opportunity to improve, to build on our organizations, to build on teaching our young Muslim brothers and sisters in a way that relates to their life but respects orthodoxy, and empowering them to speak back to our communities.
Good.
I would say, as an analogy, I'm quite scared as a public speaker. I've overcome it slightly because I approach that fear.
Mm-hmm.
If you feel a fear of the fear of Islam, of the hatred of Islam, that will diminish when you engage in interacting with that fear. Mm-hmm. If you feel there is a problem or you have an anxiety about people's hatred or perception to you, please, make an effort. Yeah. Talk to those people. Yeah. That's my advice.
Brother Munir?
I think it's happening right now with Sigilanya Bermula Desini. Mm-hmm. TV Al-Hijra is a vehicle in which to reach out to the common person. We're not here with books of hadiths and all this on the table, which a lot of people cannot relate to. We have to speak to people's hearts. Mm. When we do that, you'll see change.
All right. Dilis Rada, there's a very good conclusion we have made. Kita juga dapat satu kesimpulan yang menarik dan saya percaya anda telah dapat iktibar di sini. Apapun saudara, yang saya boleh katakan pada sini ialah salah satu, kita sendiri adalah duta untuk agama kita. We are our own ambassador for Islam. Jadi saudara, lakukan dengan sebaik-baiknya dan saya percaya kepada janji Allah kepada kita. Intan surullah yansurkum wa yastabit aqdamakum. Apabila kau benar-benar ingin menegakkan agamaku di muka bumi ini, niscaya aku akan menguatkan kedudukan kamu. Dengan itu saudara, bicara akan mudah, tapi sebelum itu jangan lupa sekiranya ada di antara anda yang ingin mengemukakan saranan, sila hantarkan kepada bicara@tvalhijrah.com. Sehingga ketemu lagi. Terima kasih kerana bersama kami. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Maassalamah.